Hi, we'll be talking about the ways that we are still affected by popularity and why popularity is so important. And previously, we talked about the ways that it might really be built into how our brains are set up and even how our DNA responds and is expressed. But I want to move on by talking a little bit about how popularity is affecting each and every one of us, actually, thousands of times a day. We are going to talk about how your experiences with popularity when you were younger affect a lot of the ways that we think about our social experiences. But before we do that, I'd like for you to watch this video. I just watched the video, and you are going to be asked to say a little bit about what you saw in the video, so watch carefully. What we are going to talk about now has been studied by psychologists for many years, and it referred to as social information processing. Nicky Craig and Ken Deutsch were among the first to develop a model. It's really a way of taking every single social experience you have and zooming down into super slow mode. So if you were to try and think about all the tiny little unconscious processes that are happening between the moment that you see something and the moment that you respond, you will divide them up into a few different steps. So the first thing that happens is that there is an event. This could be a big event, like someone breaks up with you, or it could be a tiny little event, like you're walking through a crowd and someone nods at you. Very subtle. It turns out that in order for us to respond to that every event, there are many little steps that happen, and the first one is whether or not we encode that event. So, for instance, if you were walking through a crowd and someone nodded at you, you might not even notice it. You might be looking at somebody else, or you might be looking at your phone, answering emails, or you might be assuming that no one is interested in looking at you. So you don't really even attend to what happens. It's very common for professors to talk about teaching in their class, and rather than noticing all of the students that are looking at them and kind of nodding, they really tend to focus on just those students that are looking down and clearly are doing Facebook while they're lecturing. And there's a really great example of queue encoding. The idea that they tend to even just notice some things more than others and actually don't even see the other things in their visual field at all. Well, once we see something, once we've encoded something and we've said that our brains has brought it to some attention to us, then we have to interpret that what is it and we have seen or heard or felt, and we call that cue interpretation. And there are many different ways that we might interpret that is that we've just encoded, and we'll talk about that more in just a second. Well, after we've interpreted something, then again, really fast, unconsciously, we don't even realize that we are doing it. We then decide what is our call. What are we hoping to achieve in this particular situation? And then becomes an important step called goal clarification. Once we have a goal, we come up with a variety of possible things that we could do respond. We select one of those responses. Again, super fast. We are not even aware we are doing it, and then we follow through on what with response enactment. So, in other words, we decided to act out what is it that we say that we saw rather that we want to do, and once we responded, that often produces a new event. So, for instance, if this all started by someone nodding to you and you end up deciding to nod back, that might lead to them waving or saying hi or something like that. If you decide instead to do something rude to them, then that might lead to some sort of events where it will start a whole new cycle, and it happens again and again. Well, all of this happened based on all of your prior experiences. So every single experience that we've had socially is stored in a database. And there is actually good brain research to say that when we look at how people respond to things, it often is involving centers of our brain involved in autobiographic memory. So we are very frequently drawing upon these old experiences, particularly as it turns out, experiences with popularity as a way to understand how every social experience happens to us every single day today. And sometimes we think about these steps very, very explicitly. We'll talk about that in a second, but first, let's talk about an example where we might see this play out, and I'm going to show you three different present people and how they might respond to a similar event. So for instance, imagine that someone walks by, they look at you. They smile and they giggle out a little bit. Well, imagine that in the queue anchoring step, the first person might look at that and say, "I just saw a person laughing at me." Okay, so they, because of your debates, they're really into laughing. The second person might say, "I just saw a person make eye contact and smile." So they didn't really remember their laughing as much. Their studies show that if you ask them later, they might not even recall that it happened, or they might not even notice it, but they're really noticing the eye contact and the smile. And the third person, maybe they're a kind of person that doesn't believe that anyone would ever smile at them. They have a lifetime of rejection or feeling that they're never noticed by anybody. Their studies show less likely to even notice when people do look at them, so they might not even notice anybody. Well, the next step that will happen then is cue interpretation. So the first person might say, "I think that person was making fun of me. I saw them kind of laughing, and my automatic thought, the thing I immediately associate with that is, I think they're teasing me somehow." But maybe the second person, who kind of was really noticing the eye contact and the smile, might interpret that by saying, "Oh, I think maybe that person is flirting with me." And of course, the third person, who didn't even see anybody, will probably say, "What person? I don't even know what I'm talking about." So that's the end of them. The next step will be goal clarification. So if you believe that someone has just teased you, that first person might say, "Well, in this situation, I want to assert my dominance. I really want to make sure that people don't tease me and they know that I'm not the kind of person that should really be treated that way." So maybe that's third goal, but you know, someone else might say, "Oh, well, I'm actually scared they tease me, and I'm a little bit frightened, or I feel really embarrassed or depressed, so I'm going to go withdraw, and I really want to get out of this situation." That might be a different goal. Second person who saw the exact same event as something that had to do with 13 might say, "Oh, wow, they seem pretty hot. I want to date them." So that might be their goal in this situation. So these goals then lead to a variety of possible responses, and automatically in our brains, we kind of scan all the things we've done in that situation before, and we think about all the things that we might be able to do. So when thinking of all the possible responses, the first person might say, "Well, I could walk over and hit that person. I could scream out at them. You know, you, oh yeah, kind of like, don't do that to me." Or I could throw thumbs in them or something like that. While the second person who think, "Oh, I think I'm being flirted with, and my goal here is to try and get a date out of this," they might walk by the person and give them a smile back. They might scream out to them, "Oh yeah," or they might go hand them their number or say that they want to tag them or something like that. So usually after we scan all the possible things we can do, we come up with our response. We decide, okay, person number one says, "I'm going to go throw my book at them." Person number two might say, "Well, if I've decided I should just smile at them." That's the best way to handle it. Interestingly, just because we decided on what is it we're going to do, that doesn't mean that's actually what we do. A lot of us have really good intentions so to do a certain things, but when we actually go and do it, it comes out a little bit different than we expected. So the person that decided to throw the book might decide to also scream out at the same time, "Take that." Whereas the second person might decide to smile back and also say something like, "Hey, how's it going?" or something like that. So all these steps are happening really, really quickly. And what's interesting is that the reason why all these things occur are because of the experiences we've had before and the experiences we've had with popularity. What we have learned is that we can predict how people will encode things, how they will interpret things, and so on. What goals they will make and what responses they consider select, and then act all based on how popularity they were as younger kids. That creates a template or a way of us interacting with the world, and it affects us thousands of times a day. Sometimes we think about this very seriously and very specifically. So for instance, imagine you have gone on first day. There may be some of these steps that you've debated about and ruminated about forever. What did they mean by that text? And that mean they like me or they don't like me, and what should I do? Should I say that back? Should I put a little emoticon, or does that seem I'm trying too hard? All these are ways that we think very specifically about these steps and even obsess ours sometimes. And that shows us that we really are engaging in these steps. But remember, most of the time it's happening automatically without us even realizing them. So here is an example. Before I asked you to watch a little video, the video had a box. And around the box, there were three circles of different colors. It would have been perfectly appropriate to respond to that video that what you saw were three circles in a box. But most of the time, to anthropomorphize that video, we tend to see a story. But what story we see, the way that we interpret that similar tells us a lot about ourselves. I have shown this video to many, many people over the year, and I want to give you a few examples of the way that people will vary when they are asked to do the exact things that I just asked you to do. Watch the video and just say what you saw. So for instance, some people will say in a more neutral way that they saw the red circle originally in the lead and the blue circle followed, then red tags green who followed and even gained the lead. Blue was very far behind and was left out of entering the square because the door closed before he got there. For instance, another person said red and blue circles went around the big circle one. They stopped, they picked up the green circle. All three circles went around the main circle once. Finally, red and green entered and closed the door. These are pretty neutral responses. Look how these contrasts with folks that said something that indicated maybe a low level of aggression. What they said was the blue circus folks forced its way into the box, bounced around for a few seconds around the red and green circles. Red and green ran out and closed the entrance on blue. Oh, the blue circle tries to make other includes him. He broke into the square and moved towards them. He threw himself against the sides of the squares near where they are standing. The other circles didn't join him. They left the square. Here's another one. Blue forced its way into the room with green and red. Blue and green bumped shoulders until green was ready to leave with red, because he didn't like hanging out with blue. Let me show you one more example. Here are people that saw the exact same video, but what they said suggested even more dramatic aggression. Here's what one person said. Okay, so red and green circle are chilling in the room. I think red is female. Blue is angry and feels left out. Clearly blames green circle for excluding it. Breaks into the room. Looks like there is violence between green and blue circles. Another person said blue banged on the door and forced it open. Blue's very mad, bouncing all over the place. Green faced up to blue. Blue and green fought. Green and red left the room and closed the door on blue. You can take a look at some of these. Here's one of my favorite. Blue busted down the box in a violent, narcissistic rage and then provoked green into a fight. Green was not in the mood for fighting because he was happy and friends with red. Red chilled in the corner, scared of blue. Then green took red out of the box. As you can see, these different scenarios and the way that people are describing them suggests that there are all kinds of attributions that make, just by seeing a simple video in which we are all encoded the same information, three circles and a box. But the way that we interpret that is dramatically different. Some people thought that they saw circles of different genders. They assumed that one was a male, one was a female. Some of them assumed a lot of aggression. Some thought that they were just playing. All of that has a lot to do with that it was like for us growing up and how popular we were. So overall, hopefully this information is showing you that popularity, in fact, really still does matter. It's mattering in a way that affecting every single social interaction that we have as adults little by little. Our social experience compares the central debates. We can change that database over time, but the database is overwhelmingly filled with experiences that happened when our brains became adult brains, and that was as a transition to adolescence. So the experiences we had as adolescents, which we mostly care about popularity back then, there are the most important pieces of that debate database, which is why popularity plays a really big role at that point. The database tells us what we even see in the world around us, what we hear, how we interpret that, what goals we make, and what behaviors we think about. We select and we decide to act on. We all have biases, whether you're very, very popular or you're very unpopular, we all have different biases. The question is, what biases do you have, and are those biases things that are helping you in life, or are they hurting you and holding you back? In the next video, I'll talk a little bit about some very common biases that we see, particularly among those who had trouble with popularity, and we'll talk about how those biases have affected people in adulthood.